We talk about where we ended up right here on the S&P 500 on this day, and you look back at where those forecasts were at the start of this year. Quite a run here, Taylor. For more insight, let's bring in David Bahnsen. He's Chief Investment Officer at the Bahnsen Group, who joins us today from Newport Beach, California. David, the rotation trade, that's what everybody seems to be buying into here. What do you make of it?
Well, I view it as more than a trade. I think it is going to be a secular and multi-year theme in markets, just as the thing we're trading out of has been very secular and certainly multiple years. You have a kind of bifurcated market right now between certain portions that are at very rich valuations. When you say overvalued, it almost implies a timing mechanism, and I don't want to do that because we can't time when this might reverse. But what we can time, or excuse me, what we can state is that there is a very overvalued portion of the market and there's an undervalued portion. And we can look to price to book, price to earnings, any number of historical metrics to establish that. But ultimately, yeah, we believe that you're going to see a rotation into things that are more traditionally referred to as value and out of the very frothy valuations that exist in portions of technology and large cap growth.
So, but David, then I guess one of the risks there in that type of positioning right now is that a lot of the things that would sort of scream potential value, I guess, would be some of the stocks that really got beaten down because of the COVID crisis and the recession that was born out of that. So you talk about, you know, travel companies, entertainment companies, a lot of the discretionary spending type of names. Are you confident that some of those names are going to find their way back to some sort of solid footing next year?
Well, I think it has to be looked at from a bottom-up standpoint, because I think there's actually a lot of names in those groups you refer to that are going to struggle mightily. I wouldn't look at it as a wholesale rally in all of the sort of COVID distress sectors. When I refer to value, I'm not just looking to the areas, as you say, that were most pandemic affected. Although I do think there are names there from a balance sheet standpoint and earnings capability into the future that probably do warrant a look, whether it's hospitality, travel, retail, et cetera. But I don't think that this value growth distortion started with COVID. I think it had started well before COVID and just merely accelerated through the pandemic moment. And so for us to be able to find value, we have to be able to calculate what we see earnings growth being into the future and determine if we think cash flow generation is possible that represents an opportunity at a present stock purchase, right? And to me, there are plenty of names in those sectors, even though they're distressed, even though they seem to be at a low price, let's say on a book value basis, they're not going to be great free cash flow generators into the future. So that's why it's a really limited pool. We think it's an incredible opportunity for active managers, but equity investors are going to have to be selective. If not, it just means you become a sort of index investor. And an index investor right now is more or less a large cap growth investor because of the weightings in the S&P 500, the FANG trade. You just end up buying more of what has been working. Perhaps it continues to work, but that's not our thesis, not on a risk reward basis. We'd rather buy what we think is more opportunistic, which is more selective.
David, I'm wondering if higher yields are good for growth in equities, or if that means that you now have a higher discount rate and a lower present value of what the equities are worth.
Well, there's no question a higher yield is very bad for growth, and that the zero bound is a big part of why large cap growth has gotten some of these absurd valuations. The only problem with it is I'm not sure that we could look at a 90 basis point 10-year as a higher yield. Now it's higher than 70, but that's what we're talking about now. We're talking about on the margin, a bunch of discount rates that are all still really low. And by the way, even if they were to creep up higher, I'm quite sure that the Fed would end up bringing in yield curve control. They want a certain amount of steepness in the curve, but they don't want the long end of the curve getting much higher. The question for large cap growth investors is whether or not staying low is good enough versus going lower. And that's what I think they've been enjoying for a long time is a discount rate that has been going lower. I believe it will stay low. I'm just not sure that's going to be enough to keep boosting valuations. Earnings have grown at X, but multiples have grown at 2 or 3 times X. So they're not going to be able to sustain that. And so that's a lot of our rotation thesis going into 2021.
Are your clients asking you about Bitcoin?
Oh, not anymore. I think they got tired of hearing my answer. And so we don't hear that a lot from our clients, but it's certainly out there and it's a popular conversation. And now it will become more popular with this recent rally. The thesis I was told was that the dollar was very unstable and that Bitcoin and crypto represented some sort of alternative to the instability of central banks and the U.S. dollar. And what we've seen out of Bitcoin pricing since it came into the public scene doesn't strike me as particularly stable. I don't touch it and have no intention of touching it.
David Bahnsen, Chief Investment Officer at the Bahnsen Group. Thank you, as always, for your comments on fundamentals and then a little Bitcoin in there, Romain.